I'm Ron Freeman, and I'm running for sheriff of Forsyth County.
I know a lot of you in here. I see a lot of people I don't know in here.
Most of you know my platform. My platform has been very simple in a couple of areas. It's a primary thing. I believe in putting a police officer in every school. It is paramount with the drug problem that we have. It's a simple fact that we don't live in a safe world anymore. It's not a scare tactic. It is exactly what I said it is. We got the school shooting here in 1990. We never thought it could happen. We never thought our courthouse would be attacked. But it happened. And if we're going to put grown men and women protecting men and women in the courthouse, which we should do, then by gosh, I think we should put men and women with guns protecting our elementary school kids as well. If we're going to protect the high school kids, then let's protect our elementary school kids as well. Drug problem is out of control here. We have way too few resources working on narcotics. We have a really big, broad base of things that are going on in the community to try to help with drug addiction and drug education. I'm fully in support. I love what they're doing. Some of the drugs, some of the stuff. I think they're doing a great thing. But I remind everyone, there's only one entity in Forsyth County that can do anything about drug dealers and drug traffickers bringing drugs into our community. And that's people with badges and guns. So that has to be our primary focus, has to be stopping the influx of drugs coming into our community. I talked about national accreditation, the fact that we were a national accreditation agency for 12 years. And then we failed and lost that national accreditation. That can't be. This is Forsyth County. Look at our school system. Look at our quality of life. Yeah, it's a real simple question. Do you want your sheriff's office to be accredited or not? It just even sounds good if you say it. It's not even one of those, it sounds good if I say it fast enough. It is the only independent review that you will have of your sheriff's office actually meeting standards. Because other than that, unfortunately, the sheriff answers to no one except the voters every 4 years. He doesn't even answer to the county commissioners. So I've talked about those things. And those are some of the primary things I've talked about, as well as reopening our South Precinct. Those are things that have to be done to keep our community safe. I know we got people coming in. We got more chairs coming in. I never expected this crowd. Thank you for being here.
Tom, we got a bunch of questions. The spirit of transparency. I don't have time to get to all these coming in. So I'll let you pick one, and then we're going to let Ron answer it. How's that? All right. First question up. This is from Reed. Why has there been such a large turnover in the sheriff's office?
Okay. The sheriff's office has had almost a 40% turnover. Some people have challenged me on that number. It's real simple. You guys have a graduate degree in public administration. I'm fairly good at math. It's not my strongest subject. But if you lost about 144, as of a couple of months ago, last I kept up with it, we've lost 144 employees since January 1, 2013 until a few months back. The sheriff's office has almost 400 people with staff. They only have about 360 to 370 currently employed. 144 out of 368, rounded up, is 40%. Okay? I mean, you can get your phones out, right? Get your calculators out and see what that does. But if I remember correctly, I think I used 368, which was the last field number I saw at the sheriff's office. And it came out to 39-something%. It was above 0.5. So yes, I rounded up to 39.5 to say 40. I did. Okay. But that is a 40% turnover. And I can tell you from having worked here for 25 years, that's an incredibly high number. And what was even scarier when we started looking at that, what was a lot of our veteran officers. It was a lot of officers with 5 and 10 years experience. And civilian officers, or civilian employees with 5 and 10 years experience. Guys, we paid a lot of money to train those people up to a certain level. And if you think you can just hire a kid, and no offense to you, I was a kid when I got hired, right? I was a young gun starting out, 20 years old when I started, right? But if you don't think that it takes time and money to raise them up to a certain proficiency level, it does. They may be superstars in the making, but they're not yet. And then what concerned me even more was I saw that the folks we hired in the last 2 years are now leaving. And we wanted to know why. So I asked for the exit interviews. If any of you work in the industry, you do exit interviews when people leave your company, you see a lot of heads going up and down. The sheriff's office response to an open records request was, we don't do exit interviews. If you're not doing exit interviews, you're not tracking why your people are leaving. If you're not tracking why your people are leaving, what can you do to stop them from leaving? It's got to be important. We're losing billions of dollars walking out the door when we lose this interview.
All right, next question.
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. All right. It says, as former assault victim and mother in the campaign flyer using actual victim statements. What would you say to be to would-be victims who may now be afraid to come forward against a criminal, and more specifically against the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office and their deputies?
Amen.
I read it right? I'll leave the name off of this one.
I told you, if you know me, I'm blunt and I'm honest when I say things. That's sleazy politics that has no business in law enforcement. Guys, when you wear a gun and a badge and you swear your oath to protect people, you don't betray that oath. And when you use a person's statement that came in to file that, in this case in a complaint or in any other complaint, whether it be criminal, complaint on an officer, whatever it is, it was not intended nor was it ever meant to be used for political purposes. I think it's a shame. I think it's embarrassing. And I think, just call it, never in my entire life would I ever dream or could I ever do that. Not only would my wife beat me, my mom and dad would beat me, but it's just, guys, it's a matter of integrity. I said earlier, I said a couple of days, I would rather lose this race than do that. So not me, I won't do it, I never would do it, and if anybody under my command ever did it, they wouldn't be working for me again.
From Jennifer, will we help neighborhood watching community programs we have had for so many years, and what does servant leadership mean to you?
Okay, let's divert it. So will we keep? Absolutely, we'll keep neighborhood watch and all the community programs we do. Guys, we've been doing these community programs not just for the last 3 years. We've been doing them since the 25 years I've worked at the Sheriff's Office, since 1987. I started teaching women's self-defense courses and women's handgun courses. We've been teaching these things for 25 years. And we've added some new programs along the way. And they're good. And we'll keep the ones that are valuable in doing that. There's no reason to think we'd ever take that away. Neighborhood Watch, will we keep it? Not the format it's in now. But we'll do it in a way that actually provides some service to you. We'll have police officers who work in your neighborhood, adopt your neighborhoods. You'll know who they are. You'll know their phone numbers. And you'll actually have interaction with the man or woman who works in your neighborhood. Right now, if you have a problem, you call a captain. I'm sorry, you call your community relations officer, who calls a captain, who calls a lieutenant, who calls a sergeant, who tells a corporal, who tells a deputy, somewhere down the line to take care of a problem. And at that point, it's probably a pink elephant with polka dots on it they're trying to take care of, like a telephone game. I want it down at the street level. So the people that are working in your neighborhoods, I'm not talking about a 911 call when somebody broke in your house, but the people working in your neighborhoods, when you have that problem, the loud music, the kids that you think are selling drugs next door, you actually can talk to the officers working in your neighborhood who can make a difference. What is servant leadership? Switching gears, it's real simple. It's not putting yourself first. It's putting people like victims first. It's putting your employees first. And important, it's putting the citizens first. It's not about titles. It's not about badges. I've had titles and badges. I've had badges that said chief. I've had badges that said commander and captain. It's not about me. Servant leadership is about putting other people first and helping them succeed and keeping you safe.
All right. Make sure I read it right. This one's from John. With the drug issue at hand, do we need more drug officers? How many do we have now?
We're in an epidemic, guys. And I can tell you, after serving a couple of years in Brookhaven, downtown Atlanta, Buford Highway, let me ask a question. Who thinks the drug problem is obviously worse in downtown Atlanta? Just a couple of you. I'm kind of surprised. I thought more of you raised your hand. Here's what I can tell you. Our youth and young adults use drugs at a higher rate here than I ever saw in downtown Atlanta. It is absolutely scary. The survey we did at high schools knocked my socks off. 56% of kids said they smoked marijuana in the past 12 months out of about 1,000 respondents. 68% said they abused alcohol in the past 12 months. Does that mean all our kids are druggies? No, I'm not saying that. But I'm also realistic. I have a son who's a junior at North Forsyth High School. My youngest is a 17-year-old. And I see a couple of other folks in here that are seniors and at the same school in some other places, one that's graduating, a couple of seniors in here. And I could just ask a couple of these young folks to stand up right now and say, how bad is the drug problem here? And they'll tell you, it's out of control. We have two people working narcotics in Forsyth County right now. Two. I said it in the debate, and if your problem's here, I'd say it again right now, and I'd hand you a piece of paper again. In the last 3 years, we've had as many as four and five, then it went to four, then it went to three, one of them being a sergeant, and for the last year, it's been two. I know the officers. They used to work for me on my crime suppression team. They were very good police officers, very good deputy sheriffs. But you can't work drugs with two people. That's got to change. We've got 11 people in social media, community relations, and PR, and we've got two people working drugs, and we have a drug epidemic on our hands. We are tied for the third highest drug overdose death rate in the state of Georgia. Let me qualify that where I got hammered in the debate for a moment. There are four counties in the state of Georgia who do not report to the GBI, so we don't know what their numbers are. That is DeKalb, Gwinnett, Fulton, and Cobb. They have their own medical examiner. I have no idea what their numbers are. I have not done an open records request. They may be higher, they may be lower. The number one out of the other 155 counties, those not knowing what their numbers are, number one is next door Cherokee County. Number three, we're tied with Clay County right here in Forsyth County. Yes, we have a drug problem, and we better do something about it. That starts with the police officers in the elementary schools doing education and mentoring. It starts with police officers and deputy sheriffs in the middle schools becoming superheroes to our young people and modeling good behavior, helping them make better decisions. And then it comes with narcotics guys kicking drug dealers in the behind and putting them in jail, because those are the folks that need to be in prison. Not the kid who makes a mistake, not the addict, but the people selling drugs for profit. I want them in prison.
From Nydia, and it says, what is your education?
Okay. Well, I graduated right here at Forsyth County High School, and there was only one high school in the county where I met my lovely wife 29 years ago. After that, I went to Georgia Southern for a little while and came back and went to work for the sheriff's office and realized if I was going to be successful, I had to complete my education. If I wanted to move up in positioning and rank, and in leadership capacity, I needed to finish my education. So I went back to school. I went to University of Georgia / Gainesville College, got an associate's in criminal justice. Went from there. I was blessed to go to the FBI National Academy. I completed a three-month executive training program there with the University of Virginia. From there, I went to Reinhardt University to finish my bachelor's in organizational leadership. From there, I became very blessed. I went to the FBI Executive Leadership School in Quantico, Virginia. And after that, I was actually awarded a scholarship for a graduate degree from the FBI. So I completed my graduate degree, Master's in Public Administration, and I really lost my head because I started a doctorate in public policy. So my entire life, I've been trying to better myself and become more educated, because police work has changed. It's way more technical. It's way more complicated than it used to be. There's still a lot of the old ways, and communications and relations with people are still the same. The technologies, processes, theories have changed, and you better stay abreast of it. And that's why I work so hard to keep my education up.
Pick one. Pick anyone you like.
No.
Oh, all right, keep me on. This one's from Ken. What makes you more qualified than the current sheriff?
That's a fair question. I get asked that all the time in big groups. Why should we vote for you? I mean, I admit that's a fair question. Why pick me over somebody else? Because in reality, what I'm asking you to do is hire me for the job and not hire him. I'll say a couple of ways. One, I'll just tell you the education that I just mentioned. Guys, as president of the FBI Academy, I traveled all over the country, and I got to see police departments, good and bad, and programs good and bad, all over this country. Not just the way we've always done it here in Forsyth County, not that some of the things we do here are not really good. But I got to see new techniques, I got to see new programs, new opportunities, and I can bring that stuff back to Forsyth County, and we can tailor it to fit Forsyth County. If you've never seen it, you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you always got. You ever heard that one? Okay. And I'll put it this way. If I was going to apply for a police chief job, let's qualify the difference between sheriff and police chief. If I was applying for a police chief job, I would be in front of a hiring board, just like if you were applying for a company, there would be a city manager and a hiring board, and they would be looking at resumes and qualifications. And if I walked in and said my highest rank had been a lieutenant, and I had a high school diploma, and I was applying for a 400-person police department chief job, I would not get an interview. Not to anybody else, it's just the fact of what it is. You better have a resume, and you better have shown that you worked and continued your whole career to make yourself better. Sheriff is not that. Sheriff is in a elected position, and unfortunately, at times it becomes a popularity contest. Not always the most qualified, and we all have to admit it. Sometimes we all go into that voting booth and we go, I don't know who either one of those two people are. Right? I'm well read, and I try to always be educated when I go in. But every now and then, I'll go in there as a public service commissioner, an appellate court judge, and I just didn't look at, and I'm like, I have no idea. That's why I love that you're here, that you're asking questions, because now you can make an educated decision. I'm going to ask for your vote at the end of this thing, but what I'm going to really ask you to do is make an educated decision. And if you make an educated decision based on what you've heard from me and what you saw otherwise, then what more could I ask of you?
All right, next up, keep me honest here, this one's from Darlene. How can the GBI stats show zero murders when Forsyth County news articles show several?
So let me explain what's called uniform crime reports. So here's how these things work. Every law enforcement agency in the state of Georgia, actually nationwide, is required to submit their crime statistics in Georgia. Let's go back to Georgia for a minute. Every law enforcement agency in Georgia, including when I was in Brookhaven here in Forsyth County, we submit our crime statistics numbers to the GBI. It is an electronic submission. In other words, GBI can't mess it up. It's data in, data out, garbage in, garbage out. You understand some of that technology talk that I just used there. Whatever Forsyth County put in and submitted in their electronics is what's going to show up in the GBI. I did see that. It got sent to me. Forsyth County is showing zero murders for 2014. They're showing zero murders for 2015. That is wrong. It is inaccurate. How did you miss that? I have no clue. Because when I was a South Precinct Commander, I could tell you month to month exactly how many burglaries I had. Because you know what? I was held responsible for every burglary that happened in South Forsyth. And my bosses wanted to know that I knew what was going on. I read every police report. I did those things. How do you get zeros? Somebody's not watching. And somebody's not paying attention. There's no other explanation for it. Let's see.
All right, this one's from Linda. What are the most significant differences between you and Piper?
I think I kind of answered that. Anybody wants me to go? I mean, I think I answered that. Does everybody agree, or do you want me to go into something else? I didn't want to. And Linda, I'm sorry if I'm not answering your question, but I think I've covered that. If you got anything else, whoever it was, stand up and tell me. I'll be glad to answer. That's all.
All right, next question. This one's from Robert. Will you get or will you release the Kalia report that was deleted?
As fast as IT can pull it out of the deleted file. Let me qualify one thing on that. Folks, I had to do IAs and I had to do other things. If you work in corporate or you work in government, when you delete an email is not deleted. There's a backup server, and there's backup copies, and there's retention policies and retention laws in the state of Georgia. Things have to be kept for a certain amount of time. I have had to ask for deleted emails when I was doing investigations into police officers with deputy sheriffs here before. I would email the IT director, they would get one of their people, and generally in about 20 minutes, my inbox would go bing, and there it was, pulled back up. It's there, I'll get it. And I'll release it, and we'll fix what's wrong with it.
All right, next question. Two questions. What is the good, bad, and ugly animal control part of Forsyth County Sheriff's Office?
Okay. So good, bad, the animal control unit that works for the sheriff. It is a division or a unit of the sheriff's office. The simple fact of it is, for a while, they had these men and women who worked animal control. You see them in the animal control trucks, black and white trucks. They had them working on shifts with patrol officers. They had them escorting funerals and things in animal control trucks. That just doesn't, I'm sorry. It's that level of professionalism. You just don't do these things.
Don't knock the officers who did it. If they were leading a funeral in one of those trucks, they got told to do it, and you know what? They did it with as much honor and integrity as they could. So I'm not knocking those men and women. I am not. But we got to do better. We worked with the shelter. When we started animal control, when animal control started, we built a new shelter. All our animal control officers were guess where their house? At the animal control shelter, working with things. Now guess where they're at? Not at the animal control shelter. They built offices in there for the sheriff's office, for the animal control officers. Why are we not working side by side, hand in hand, with the director of the animal control shelter and with the Humane Society? Folks, I would love to see this turn to a no-kill shelter. You're going to find out something about me. I'm a huge dog guy. My wife and daughter like cats. I'm a huge dog guy. I want to see the shelter turn into a no-kill shelter, and I want to see a start program in that big old jail that has a bunch of empty space that people call it prisoners and pooches. They call it prisoner dog, jail dog programs, whatever it is, where we take stray dogs that are taken in, we let prisoners train them for basic obedience, and we make them twice as adoptable. And tell me how a prisoner is not going to be better off working with an animal.
Amen.
Should animal control be part of the department, and what needs to make it better?
Well, I think I answered that. So the shelter itself is not part of the sheriff's office. The animal control unit who takes the stray dog stuff and takes them to the shelter is. I'm really at a disadvantage because that happened after I left to go to Brookhaven. I'm at a little bit of a disadvantage to be able to answer that until I sat down with both the commissioners, the people who run the shelter, and that animal control unit to say whether those things should be consolidated together. I think there's a potential there, but I wouldn't want to say it right now until I did my research.
All right, it's from Vanessa. What do you plan to do differently from what Ted Paxton did?
I'll tell you, I plan to do a lot of things differently than you. Because I'm Ron Freeman. The deal is, guys, I have my own experiences. I worked for 6 different sheriffs during my time here and 1 police chief. And I spent a lot of time working with the FBI. And so I had an opportunity when we went to Brookhaven. Who's ever got a new job or got, you were the boss or got promoted to manager, you thought, man, if I ever get in this position, I'm going to try this. It'll be different when I, okay? I got to try some of those things. And most of them worked. Wow. Some of them didn't. We had to revamp. But our technology in Brookhaven, because we were a brand new city, we got to build a police department from the ground up. There was nothing there. I got there was me and the chief. There were 2 laptops and 2 iPhones. That was the start of the Brookhaven Police Department. 2 desks, 2 laptops, 2 iPhones, and 2 desk phones. From there, we built everything off from the ground up. There's a couple of folks in here I hired there who helped start that police department up. And we got to try some things. And the technology there is really different than what we use here. We had crime mapping. Citizens can go online in Brookhaven and pull up their address or any address and pull up however distance they want to go from it. And they can see every crime that's happening. It's updated every 4 hours. You can click on a dot and read the police report. Okay? Now, it is a generic police report. It doesn't go into great detail, and it doesn't say at 123 Elm Street, at Stan Rutledge's house, it says in the 100 block of Elm Street, a residential burglary occurred. So at least you know what happened, right? You can do that. It's updated every 4 hours. It's at the touch of your fingers. We'll put out a weekly crime report that actually tells you what's going on. We'll use a Facebook page that actually tells you about crime. Okay? Guys, we'll do all the warm and fuzzy stuff too. It's great. It's community relations. We need to do it. But we need to tell you about crime at the same time. You need to know what's going on in your community. Police cars in Brookhaven. How many of you ever had an officer blow the paint off your car when they go by your car with no lights and siren and they're running way fast? Well, guess what? If you broke over 20, I'm trying to remember, oh, if you hit 85 in the police car in Brookhaven, it automatically recorded, turns your camera on, recorded it as a speed detection, and sent a notice to a supervisor that you were speeding. Now, we would look at those videos and seeing maybe the guy's running the lights and siren going to a bank robbery, and I'm done. I don't need it. Okay, he's doing what he's supposed to be doing. He or she is. But if they were on 985 on the way home or going to McDonald's running 92 miles an hour, they need to be held accountable, because you know what? This is dangerous. We write you a ticket for speeding, and we're doing it ourselves. So we use technology. We have GPS on our cars. We use things called micro hotspot policing, where we can predict crime. We have crime announcers. We used to have a full-time crime analyst here. We have none now. You know, guys don't even get written pass-down sheets to tell them what's going on in the community. We can do a lot better with technology than what we're doing here. Those are the things that I'll bring that will be different. I'll reopen the South Precinct. I'll change the neighborhood watch to the program that we kind of revolutionized with our impact in Brookhaven. It worked really well. We'll bring it here. And we will get our officers off the road, back in your communities, talking to you. That's what I think we're missing. We're missing that community interaction between the beat officer and the people in the neighborhoods, so we're talking together and finding out what's going on.
Next question is from Nick. How do you intend to keep officers and recruit experienced officers in the sheriff's office?
First off, we'll do exit interviews and track what they're leaving while they're leaving. More importantly, we can do something really backwards here. Okay? So, this officer here is a 21-year-old young man or woman who put themselves in the police academy with a high school diploma. We start them at, I'm going to use round numbers, $39,000 a year. Officer B is a 15-year veteran of, let's say, the Roswell Police Department, with a master's degree, is bilingual, speaks Spanish, and has 10 years of homicide detective experience, and thousands of hours of training. We start him at $39,000 a year. How, oh how, can you recruit experienced, qualified people unless we're willing? Do you know how much money we will spend as a county to get one of our 21-year-olds 10 years up in training at that experience level? I don't have to pay them $70,000 a year, but I can't pay them $39,000. And paying them an extra $8,000 or $10,000, we proved it in Brookhaven. We had a pay scale based on education, training, and experience, and it was set to hit certain criteria you got up to. And there were some people who were making it in the upper 40s. That was the very top tier of walking in the door. But we paid for that experience. It sounds high, $10,000. That's less than I spend in training for this 21-year-old in 1 year for $10,000 extra. We have to be willing to pay for that experience, and we can't expect that we can recruit people without doing that.
Amen. All right, next question is from Ashley. What will you do about physical fitness in the deputies?
I'll lose my 10 pounds. 15. Thanks. It is imperative that police officers be able to do the job. I was SWAT team leader, assistant commander in SWAT team. I know about physical fitness on the job. I know about its importance. We don't need every police officer to be in a SWAT standard, climbing 20-foot ropes and jumping over things. That is a different level. That's almost a military level standard. But they got to be able to get out of cars. In every agency that happens, we have to have physical fitness standards. They've implemented some physical fitness standards. We were missing those. But the problem is, there's very little accountability in these physical fitness standards. And I watched Sandy Springs Police Department, which is a very good police department, do a very good thing. And they started their physical fitness program, and they started with a carrot, not a stick. And so they brought in nutritionists, dietitians, doctors. They started working with the folks who were overweight, and they started giving them some incentives to get better. If you meet the top tier of their standard, you're the first one that gets a new car. You get some extra days off. I'm just using it as an example. If you meet the basic standard, you can work part-time jobs and you still get a take-home car. If you fail to meet the standard, you lose your take-home car and you can't work part-time jobs. There's an incentive to get back. Now, at a certain period of time after so long, if they can't meet that standard and they can't perform those basics of what a police officer has to do that is related to their job, not having push-up things to do, but related to what a police officer does, then, you know, unfortunately, you can't be a police officer right then. I mean, it's a hard fact. It's harsh. And I'm not saying I'm going to go in there and every guy or girl that's got a little bit of a belly, they're going to get, no, we're going to work with them. We're going to do that. But they have to be responsible for working on their own. And if they're gaining an
Why do you think this election has become so nasty among residents? Facebook, Forsyth political views, deputies hiding and posting under false names.
That's a good one. I've been doing this almost 30 years, and I'm a near constitutionalist in my belief, as far as my conservative beliefs, and I'm fully in support of any citizen having their First Amendment rights. But I have never seen a police department or sheriff's office where officers speak out and represent themselves as officers and speak out and argue with citizens on social media. I've never seen it in my life. It's not proper. It's not professional. It's not, in my vision, ethical. First Amendment rights are First Amendment rights. But there are some standards that you have to meet when you're posting or you're talking as a police officer, as a deputy sheriff, about being a police officer or deputy sheriff. If they want to go out and talk about Trump versus Hillary and their street clothes, they have every right that anybody has, and I fully support that. Why has it gotten nasty? Because somebody's gotten desperate because they think they're about to lose their job. It's gotten nasty because of that. I haven't gotten down the mud. I've been talking about the same thing for over a year. The same issues. Why did we lose accreditation? Why did you delete a report? Why are you taking cash from contractors? Why almost half your campaign contribution came from contractors who you have control over as a sheriff? Bonding companies, towing companies, car companies, jail architects, mail companies at the jail. I've asked those questions. Why are you buying $60,000 Ford Raptor trucks? Why are you closing the South Precinct? Why do you only have two narcotics officers? I'm sorry, that to me, and I hope that you agree with me, that's not mud. That's asking legitimate questions, and I'm also at the same time I'm asking as I'm telling you what we'll do different to make it better for South County. And if you can't answer that, you're probably gonna find some mud and it's gonna get dirty.
Next question is from Dan. Says, what about social media? You said you would cut social media staff. How are we still going to have media and how?
Yeah. So I kind of answered that before. Yes, we'll still have social media. Yes, we'll actually add some new technologies. There's things like Code Red, some others. I'm just using that as an example. It's an opt-in technology. So if you want to be notified of something in your neighborhood or you don't want to be notified, you can choose to or not get that information. We'll do social media. What I said is, and it's been, you know, the other side has skewed this, is I'm going to cut the social media staff, I'm going to fire them all over, and we're going to come off the Facebook page. Not what I said. What I said is I don't need cops doing Facebook. I don't need men and women with badges and guns that can be protecting our community doing social media. I can hire an intern from one of the colleges. I can hire a civilian communication specialist, and they probably will be a lot better versed at it than what we do right now. Police officers need to be police officers. Deputies need to be deputies. And we still, it's a vital, listen, the world's changed. I understand that. Social media and all the mediums for social media are big. We have to be able to communicate however we can to everybody in this room. But it doesn't have to be a man or a woman with a gun and a badge behind a desk, do it.
This next question is from Chris. Please advise on your top three priorities when you are elected sheriff.
Officer in every school. Reopen the South Precinct and put some real teeth in our narcotics unit. And I can do them really fast. Okay, good. I'm gonna take one from the audience.
Go ahead.
Why was the South Precinct closed? Got me. We had about 65 or 70 deputies, men and women, who worked out of the South Precinct and protected South Forsyth. Make no bones about what I'm saying. I live in North Forsyth. I grew up in South Forsyth. We had a North Precinct identical that had 35 or 40 deputies in it who protected North Forsyth. Why more and less? Because there's more people that live in South Forsyth and less that live in North Forsyth. Wasn't even less coverage for population. But now every day, every morning, we have every uniform patrol deputy, guys and girls in uniform, black and white cars, who report to and drive from Central Park all the way to South Forsyth in rush hour traffic every morning and every afternoon. The sergeants and lieutenants' offices are at North Precinct. They drive back and forth to there. It makes absolutely no sense. Why would we not put our people where our customers are? And our customers are you, and 65% of calls for service come from South Forsyth. Therefore, 65% of our officers should be in South Forsyth. You spent almost $3 million to build that building in 2006. I know I was the first one that ran it. I was the first commander of that unit and that precinct. I don't need to go hire 65 officers. They're there. I just need to do a stroke of the pen and put them back in South Forsyth and make sure North Forsyth has exactly what they need to protect them as well. And like I say that to the people of North Forsyth. I live there. I have a vested interest.
Next question. This is from Kevin. You mentioned hiring more officers for our schools. Can you explain that, and how would we do that without raising the budget?
Great question. So, first way we do that is we get rid of 11 police officers in community relations, social media, and PR. When I say get rid of, we get rid of the job that they're doing and replace it with. We will still have community relations officers, but we'll have a couple in North Precinct and a couple in South Precinct. That opens up five or six positions right there. You folks have been paying in the sheriff's office budget for the last 3 years for positions that you never got. You pay for deputy sheriffs, sometimes as many as 60, sometimes as little as 20, that each year were never hired, were never filled, and never provided service to you, but yet you pay taxes for it. The budget's already there. How about I just fill the existing positions? I don't need to ask for any more. I'm going to say it. Sheriff Piper was quoted in Forsyth County News a couple of months ago as saying, you can't use drug money, federal asset seizure monies, for school resource officers or for school safety. That's illegal. I suggest he goes back and read the rules. I sit with the Department of Justice about every month in the FBI, and their rules specifically say you can't use it for salaries. But maybe if he had read down one more line, he would have saw where it said, unless it's a specialized position like DARE or school resource officer, then the money can be used for it. We get about $700,000 a year in drug seizure money coming in this county on average. I don't need to buy $60,000 more drafters. I'd rather have an officer at your school.
Precinct is still open and business as usual, true or false? You kind of already answered this, but that's the question.
I'll ask it. Is it open? If you go in the door from 8 to 5, 9 to 5, you can walk in and open the door, yes, you can. There's about 15 detectives who dress like this, okay, who work out of that building. And I think two or three of them work into the evening at like 9 or 10 at night. They drive unmarked cars. They don't answer 911 calls. I'm not saying they're not good police officers. That's not their job. They investigate crimes after the fact. So having all of them in South Forsyth makes as much sense as having all the patrol deputies in North Forsyth. We have burglaries in North Forsyth too. We have crimes in North Forsyth too. And then here's what we're missing. We have a deputy sheriff walking down the hall. Trust me, I saw it 1,000 times. And a detective walking down the hall, and they stop. You see them talking about the football game last night or whatever, and go, I'm looking for Jimmy. I know Jimmy drives a blue truck, and you see them start talking and transferring information. And what do you know? Jimmy's in jail the next day because they're talking. Right now, all the detectives are over here. All the patrol deputies are over here. Makes absolutely no sense. Is the building open? Yes. Is it a precinct? No, it's not.
So if they didn't even save money by closing the building?
No, the building's still open. They're still paying for upkeep of the building, power, lights, water, all those kind of things. Absolutely.
I went by there Friday evening, locked down.
And it's not a full service precinct. We will open it back up. There will be people there. I will tell you one of the crazy things in technology right now. How hard is this? If you want to go get a police report, my wife's friend called her and said, I need to go get, I think it was an accident report, wasn't it, honey? Accident report. And I said, tell her to go by South Precinct to get it. Okay, she's here. I can tell that. I'm going to come back. Can I impose on you for a second? Okay. Where did you go? You had to go to the jail. What area of the county do you live in? North, south, east, west?
Drew Campground.
Okay, Drew Campground. Far south, southwest. South Precinct is a lot closer than the jail. Why in today's world, in the computer system of things we have, would we send someone to the jail to pick up a police report? Why can't we, I don't know, email it to them? Come down and do these kind of things. We work for you.
When I went there, they were passing out people to go into the jail.
So
I had to walk by.
That makes you feel good.
I
mean,
right?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And it's an easy fix.
All right, we got two up there written. If you guys have any more, please send them back. We're going to open up for questions in a minute. The next one is from Chris. Why is accreditation important? What is the difference between state accreditation and national accreditation?
Well, first of all, there's no such thing as state accreditation. There's state certification. And I'll tell you the difference between national accreditation and state certification. If you're nationally accredited, the state certification recognizes that as being such a high level that they say, just show us that you meet these 19 little standards here, and we'll go ahead and give you your state certification because you're nationally accredited. If you're not nationally accredited, you have to meet 119 standards. I think it's 119 for state certification. If you're nationally accredited, it's 440 standards. Now, standards are all kind of different things, but let me say again the difference with a sheriff and a police chief and different things. As the sheriff answers to no one but you, and theoretically, every 4 years they answer to you. Every 3.5 years they answer to you, right? Who knows how the operation behind the scenes is going? This is what I've been talking about right now. There's a reason we failed our national accreditation. Don't you want an independent outside body made up of law enforcement professionals? The two that came in here was a retired police chief and a retired major from the Florida Highway Patrol. Folks with 30 and plus years of experience who came in to review the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office. It wasn't Jimmy down the street. It was professional, well-educated law enforcement officers trained to evaluate an agency. That's who came in here. That's who said we weren't passing. And why is it important? Because the citizens, other than that, I don't have to answer you but once every 4 years. I will. But the simple fact is, it is an outside body looking at you and going, your sheriff's office is doing what they say. They're walking their talk match. That's why it's important.
I've got a few more questions for you. Does anybody else want to pull one out? I've got one right here. Just raise your hand, I'll bring it to you. All right. Okay, next question. Keep being honest here. Lynn, this is from Lynn. Once you're a sheriff, how long will it take you to fix the problems left by the former sheriff and restore Kalia?
Listen, problems are problems everywhere you go. And I don't care if I went in as a police chief somewhere tomorrow or I go in as a sheriff in January 2017. It's going to take time to rebuild, retool, and really honestly to build the culture back to where it should be. It's going to take some time to do that. Kalia is a national accreditation. We will have to do a one-year look back. Part of their process is it takes a year for us to get ready and to do mock evaluation. We have to wait a year. It's not that I couldn't get it done before that. We literally, in the process, have to wait a year. It will take me until the beginning of 2018 to get national accreditation back. But the beginning of 2018, we'll have it back. That's what it is.
All right.
I've looked at the last two, so I'm going to read one just because the last one, you'll understand why in a second. It says, this is from Helen. When you are elected sheriff, will you keep the community, oh, I can't read this. Will you keep the community, what's that say? Related? Related programs such as CLEA, SALT, Guardian Call, etc. Yeah. These programs are great tie-ins between the sheriff's office and the community.
They're fantastic. And we've been running those programs, two of those programs since the 90s, since the late 90s. One of those programs, Guardian Call, I don't remember exactly when we started it, but it's exceptional. CLEA, not CLEA, C-L-E-A, is the Citizens Law Enforcement Academy. We started that back in the late 90s. I had it in Brookhaven. That tells you things. We had it in Brookhaven. We'll absolutely keep the Citizens Law Enforcement Academy. It is a no-brainer. I want to take it a step farther. I want a volunteer patrol unit. I'm stealing it from Sandy Springs again, Bray Police Department. They have a Citizens Volunteer Patrol Unit. They let volunteers come in. They get in a specially marked car with yellow lights on it. They do neighborhood checks or another set of eyes. They're not carrying badges and guns. When an officer goes to an accident scene, needs help directing traffic, they're trained and they'll go help direct traffic. So the other police officer deputy can stay on the street and protect you. We'll take it even farther than that. And SALT, seniors and lawmen together, wow, I mean, there's not a better community relation we can do with our senior, you know, our senior population in SALT. So absolutely, we'll keep running those. And just understand, we've been running for a long time. It's nothing new.
All right, does anybody else have a question they want to write? You have one you want to write or ask?
Ask.
Go ahead.
Ron, do you volunteer every morning before you go to work?
when I'm right and I'm good, I do to God.
Amen.
Yes, ma'am.
Regarding the new jail, I would assume there's some vacancies there. Would you take in prisoners from other areas to help pay for that jail?
Some of you probably heard of that. You take in another county's prisoners or federal inmates, they pay you money, it helps pay for your jail off. So citizens, taxpayers kind of get a little relief from the burden. Unfortunately, a lot of the jails around us outside of Metro have some vacancies too. It's not as lucrative as it used to be, but here's what is. And Hall County does a great, right next door, because Hall County Sheriff's Office does a great program. They have a work release program. So let me pick on, I'll use you as an example. So a judge decides he's going to put you in jail for 90 days because you were a bad girl. All right, for whatever reason, but it's non-violent, it's nothing bad, it's just, but she has a good job. Now, if you put her in jail for 90 days, what's going to likely happen to her job if she works for a company? Her job's gone. Let's say that she's renting an apartment in her house. What's going to happen to that in 90 days? Gone. Great. So now she's ready to get out of jail. We kick her out of jail. Good luck. She has no money, no house, no job. What's the likelihood going to happen? Think she's going to recidivist? You think she's likely to commit another crime? Work release program. You're going to spend the night in jail. You're going to check out every morning. You're going to go to the work that we know. We're going to verify you at work. When you get, we know you get off at 5 o'clock. You got till 5:30 to get back in the jail. We're going to give you random drug tests. We're going to send people out to the place that you work randomly to make sure you're there and doing what you're supposed to be doing. Not only that, when you check back into the jail, your paycheck get sent to the court. So your fines or your child support or whatever else, and the rest of it goes for you. Okay? So let's follow this for a second. She hasn't lost her job. There's money being put into a bank account, and guess who pays your own way in jail? It is you paying for it, and it's based on how much income that you make. So if you're flipping burgers, it might be $25 a night. If you're in an upper management position making $90,000 a year, yours might be $110 a night because we're trying to be fair. But now in 90 days when she's out, she's got a place, either money to get a place to live, still has a job, and the odds of her reoffending are much lower. We've got all this open space in this jail. Why don't we want revolving doors? Why don't we work on people who are nonviolent and don't threaten our community? Make them pay their own way so you, the taxpayers, are paying nada for it, and actually it'll actually provide some income for it. That's what I think we should do with the infrastructure.
dog question. I'm also a big dog lover, and I walk my Ricky and Lucy every day at Central Park. And I know there's a police station up there.
Yes.
And you're the area, so is that our North Precinct?
That's the North Precinct.
Okay, so lately I've noticed that there's another adjacent building that black and marked cars used to be there. And I assume those were detective cars. Now they're gone. They're gone.
Right. Those weren't detective cars. That is the supply and evidence rooms that's adjacent to the North Precinct in Central Park. Those cars that were there were police cars that we bought, and some of them sat for as long as 6 months before they were ever made ready to go out on the street. You paid for them, and they sat there for 6 months. And you talk about people leaving the agency, and you talk about other things. So imagine you're a young deputy. You see your boss driving a $70,000, $60,000 truck or nice car, Explorer, whatever else, and you're driving a 150,000-mile beat-up car, and there's 40 brand-new cars in the parking lot for 6 months every day you drive in. I don't care who you are. Listen, we all want the new shiny stuff, don't we? I mean, we all get into that thing. We all want the new shiny thing. It is a morale killer. It's a morale killer. You have to, and can it be done otherwise? Yes. We started an entire police department, including 60 cars fully equipped, and we did it in 3 months. 3.5 months to do that. And that was not just cars, that was everything from the ground up. So don't tell me you can't do it in 6 months, because I know that you can.
So, speaking of being an animal lover, particularly
dogs,
how many current canine units do we have
to fire the sheriff? 4 Malinois or German Shepherds. We have one bomb dog, I think. One bomb dog. Hadn't quite figured that part out yet. And we used to, and one of the former handlers is here right now, but I just peeked over and looked at it. We used to have 2 bloodhounds, and they were phenomenal. Listen, the 20-year dogs I'm talking about, the patrol dogs, the German Shepherds, the Malinois, the Dutch Shepherds, those dogs, they're great. They bite, they find drugs, and they track people. But ain't nothing can track like a bloodhound can track. And we have bloodhounds here. They were donated here. We did pay some money to, just as an honor to the people who did it, because it was a fallen officer's family who does the bloodhound program. They basically give dogs away, but we were fairly close, so we wanted to give back to the program that dogs were bought. We have no bloodhounds now.
So how many currently now are for drugs?
4, I believe. I think it's 4 20 assets, 20 dogs that are on patrol.
Do you need more?
Yeah, particularly with the issues that we're having with drugs in our schools, I would love to see some dogs that aren't tri or dual purpose. I would love to see some, let's say, labs or something like that. It doesn't have to be a lab. A dog that's strictly a drug dog that we can use in our schools, that would be a lot more effective. I'd like to see them a lot more. I hear from my friends, as soon as the drug dogs pull up and search the school, every kid in school knows before the dog walks in. So I would like to work with the school board and make this a lot more relevant and prevalent than what we see now. All the dual-purpose dogs, the ones that actually would go in, yes, they have bulletproof vests. Some people donate and say they only cost about $700 a piece. So if we can buy them for police officers, we certainly can buy them for dogs. So, yeah.
All right, next question. How would you address Piper's personal attack, mail and Facebook? Can you just speak to it other than what you've already said, smut, mailer aside?
Folks, it comes as this. If you can't talk about the facts and failures that are going on, when I talk about he's under budget, and he says he's under budget, when I talk about that he's taking cash from contractors, when I say I'm talking about campaign contributions, from people he has direct control of their contracts with the sheriff's office, when I talk about failing to lead and deleting documents, when I talk about buying these vehicles at twice state contract price, when you talk about those things and you don't have an answer for them, you find something else to deflect. It's a common deflection. It's exactly what you're dealing with. If you can't get your numbers up, get the other guy's numbers down. Beat him up. I joked the other day, I expected to see a flyer coming out with me in some weird costume, clubbing a baby seal and abusing a dog or something. And it's got to the point that nothing would have surprised me. I have talked about, I haven't even seen that one today. So I'm probably, am I beating something in there or anything?
You're bad.
I'm bad. So
says, Piper's Flyer came, that came in the mail today, says that you resigned under duress from the Brookhaven police. Can you explain this allegation?
I left Brookhaven December 31st, 2014, to announce that I run for sheriff. You remember when it comes down to, let me back up 1 second. I have recommendations from Brookhaven. I have letters from Brookhaven. I have newspaper articles from when I left Brookhaven with them praising me for my work there. Piper left the sheriff's office 9 months before he ran for sheriff. Now for him, that's okay. I left downtown DeKalb County where I was spending 80 hours a week to come run for sheriff because I don't know if you understand, it takes a few hours to do this. I'm looking at about 80 hours a week doing this right now. I couldn't be a police chief or deputy chief in DeKalb County and do it. I left 14 months early, but there's some nefarious activity, but 9 months was okay. So I guess I should have stayed for 9 months and then it wouldn't have been a problem. It's a ridiculous statement.
Are there any more questions from the floor? I've got one last one here. Yes, go ahead.
Can you explain the issue about the budget
Quick fuzzy math story. So in 2012, the sheriff's office budget, let's round numbers, just so I'm not going to use exact numbers, was $37 million. That included about $4.6 million of what they call the county called internal service charges. That was charges they had put into your budget to pay for things like IT and maintenance and vehicle maintenance and all kind of different things like that. That accounted for about $4.6 million. In 2013, they took about $2 million of that out. In 2014, they took about another $2 million of that out. So that's $4 million that the sheriff's budget no longer has to pay for. You're still paying for it. It's now in the county budget. It's just not in the sheriff's budget. In 2015, fast forward, the budget's about $37 million. He goes, oh, look, 2015, I'm at the same budget. Whoa, there's $4 million that they took out. You're now your budget's at $37 million. If you add the $4 million back in, it's at 41, and in reality, it was about 38 and a half, which made it almost 43 million. And he'll tell you, I gave $1 million back, I was under budget. If you look at 2015, remember I told you we were paying for a lot of deputies they never hired? That money for those deputies they never hired accounted for $3.8 million in unused salary, wages, and benefit. He gave back $1 million. If you do that simple math, let me ask the question. You have 3.8 you didn't use. You didn't use it for what you said you were going to use it for, to hire people and pay them. You gave back $1 million. Where's the other $2.8 million? Much less the $4 million that the county is now paying for. It doesn't work that way. It actually was not just, so crystal transparency, that's why I'm here. It was not just the sheriff's office. They did it for every department in the county. Everyone that had internal service charges, they were moved back to the county in 2013 and more of them in 2014. There's still some internal service charges, but it's a very small amount. But for the sheriff's office, it accounted for about $4 million over those 2 years. So if you want to compare apples to apples, compared to the 2012 budget, you have to add about $4+ million to his budget. Then you've got a true apple-to-apple comparison. The 2017 budget they just submitted the first draft for, if you count internal service charges, will be about $45 million. That's the largest budget in Forsyth County outside of the school system. It doesn't need to be that large. Yes, ma'am.
And as the sheriff, you submit a budget that you come to the conclusion this is what you're going to need.
Yes, ma'am.
Once that's approved, you have absolutely no accountability to the county commissioners or to the citizens, right? So you have to be the kind of person you are just to trust that.
The scary answer to that is you're exactly right. There is no accountability in that budget. I can't buy something personal for me, but if the sheriff wanted to go out and buy 20 Corvettes and say that's my traffic unit, he spent $100,000 on Corvettes, the commissioners can't stop him. Once the budget is set and given to the sheriff, they have unilateral, we've got some former commissioners in here, they have unilateral authority over that budget. They can spend it as they see fit. That's why you have to be transparent. That's why I said we will do a spending account online every month to show you where we are in our budget, where we spent your money, and if you see me driving a Corvette or a Ford Raptor, please, all of you come in my office, call Seymour, and just put your foot right. We need eyes.
shake my head and give you the keys to it.
Just for disclosure purposes, I'm a media spokesman and law enforcement for Baker City nearby. But will you speak to the crowd, the strengths of having relationships with area police chiefs and sheriffs and task forces and the feds, and why those relationships are imperative for our collective geographical region?
That may be one of the better questions of the night, no offense. If you don't have a network, and I'm blessed because I was president of the FBI Academy here, so I worked with almost every chief and sheriff in the state of Georgia. Our surrounding counties, we don't live in a bubble, guys. The same people are selling drugs in Alpharetta are selling drugs here. The same people selling drugs in Johns Creek are breaking into houses and cars, they're doing it here. We don't live in a bubble. They don't stop because they go, oh, that's the county line, I can't go across that one. They don't do that. Now, we did used to have a reputation that drug dealers didn't like coming here. We would try to set up drug deals with drug dealers, and they found out it was in Forsyth County, they didn't want to come here. They want us to meet them in Roswell or somewhere else, because they knew how many people were getting busted here. That was back in the early 2000s. So what is important is having those relationships. Now, we have such an opportunity. You realize Johns Creek and Alpharetta, in fact, are two fantastic police departments surrounding us that are filtering a lot of crime from getting into us. I have really good working relationships with both of those agencies. If we can work together, whether it's in a task force or just mutually with our drug units and some of our detectives working together, we can do so much more than what we're doing now. If you try to say, we're good, we don't need any help, then you know what? That's a very short-sighted view. It really is. And it takes a relationship. And those people in the agency surrounding us, Alpharetta, Johns Creek, Roswell, Sandy Springs, Dunwoody, they're all FBI National Academy graduates. That creates an instant bond with me because I was the president of the FBI National Academy. So I have an instant working relationship with them, much less the fact that I've worked with a person who was in Brookhaven. I've got that relationship. Sheriff now doesn't have that relationship.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Related to the state law enforcement agencies like State Patrol, there's also a division that's inspects trucks for safety and so forth. I mean, rumor has it that they sort of stay out of Forsyth County by warning from the current administration. How would you interrelate with the State Patrol and the other law enforcement agencies that really can come into the county if they're welcome?
Well, I do this and I go, hey, Mark, it's Ron, and Mark McDonough is the colonel over the Georgia State Patrol. He's a personal friend of mine. And I'd say, hey, can you send somebody to carry compliance at the truck folks down here? I see them in Dawson County. I rarely see them in Forsyth County. I don't know why. I'm not making any implication. I don't know why. We have a state patrol post. Motor carrier compliance, the truck folks are a different unit, but they all work under the Department of Public Safety and Colonel McDonough. And it's simple. I can tell you because I needed that help in Brookhaven when we were first starting up. I picked up the phone and I called and I said, Colonel, this is what's going on. I need help. He sent his crime suppression team down. They were there for 4 weeks just from a phone call. If you have those relationships, going back to his question, and you pick up the phone, they'll be here. I'll take help from anybody we can as long as they're ethical and moral. Okay, 1 second. Let's face up.
Mr. Freeman, how will you address the issue of human sex trafficking, and also how will you protect inmates from sexual advances from other inmates or perhaps deputies or jailers?
Great question. And you led me into one that I really wanted to talk about, and I had no idea you were going to ask that. How many of you heard about massage parlors going on here in town, and the current sheriff's office shut them down? We've heard it, okay? Let me tell you my take on that. Kudos to the officers for doing their jobs. Kudos to the commissioners for passing a new ordinance. It needs more teeth than it has right now. But let me tell you the problem. We go into a massage parlor that is probably doing illicit sex acts, and we write them a ticket because they have a bed instead of a massage table, and they have tinted windows, so we write them a ticket that shuts them down. If there's a human trafficking, sex trafficking victim who is being forced to perform these sex acts in the back doors, what did we do to help that victim or to make sure there's no victim there? We shut down the business. These places are ran by
A lot of times Asian cartels, sometimes Mexican cartels, organized crime. If we shut it down long enough, you know what they're going to do with the girls? We're going to ship them to the next place. Great, we shut down the place, we sent it to Milton or Alpharetta or Roswell or Sandy Springs. But if we had a victim, we just sent the victim with them. It takes police work to do that. We've done it here before. You do undercover investigations, you send officers in undercover. They know what we're doing. They're very good at it. They separate officers completely from their clothes and everything else because that way they can't have cameras and bugs. I'm not telling anything secret they don't know. Trust me, these places know what they're doing. They do the best they can not to get caught doing it. They're not stupid. But you have to send undercover people in, get them propositioned for sex act. Then we can go in after it's happened three or four times, arrest the owners of the business for running a criminally corrupt organization, and then guess what? The girls that are doing the illegal sex acts, I can't say that now. Guess what we do? We bring in the Human Trafficking Task Force and the FBI and some victim advocates, and we interview them, and we find out, are they criminals or are they victims? If they're victims, they don't go to jail. They get help, because that's what they need. You don't do that by writing tickets. That's the first answer. Inside the jail, it comes back to being nationally credible. It comes back to having strict standards that are there. It comes back to having officers that are well-trained and monitoring inmates, and then taking very serious any complaint that comes up and fully investigating that. That's the way that you do it in the jail. It's a problem in our prison system throughout the United States. So you have to be proactive in that, and you have to provide a medium for prisoners to come forward if they are assaulted or threatened with assault, whether it's a sexual assault or a physical assault. So you have to make sure there's a good process for them to come forward where they're not going to get hurt by bringing it forward. I think that's the answer to that.
Do you know if the FBI was brought in to provide any type of support for the women that were working at those massage places?
We didn't do anything with the women working in those places. We wrote them ordinance violation tickets, akin to a littering ticket. I'm not knocking the officers who did it. They did a great job doing what they were told to do, and we shut down some places. We did not go in and interview the girls that were there. We didn't have a criminal charge on them where we could hold them and kind of force them to sit through an interview. And listen, they don't want to come out and tell us they're scared. You have to spend time with them. That's what you have to do. You can't just go in and write a ticket and expect the girl's going to come running out and go, I'm being held as a sex slave. It's not going to happen. I wish it would, but it's not going to happen that way. We didn't do anything yet. That's
another question in the background.
Ron, does the sheriff's office currently have a social media policy? And if not, or if so, when you're elected, will you make it a little bit more stricter than it is now?
We'll have one on January 1, and it will be stricter than it is now. We will not infringe on any person's ability to exercise their First Amendment right. I told you before, I'm basically a constitutionalist in my beliefs, but we will not have deputy sheriffs arguing and berating and down-talking citizens and identifying themselves as deputy sheriffs.
Law enforcement officers, even school resource officers, have received a bad rep in the media in the past few years. My son, 17 years old, tends to automatically go to the non-law enforcement officer side. So once you do have school resource officers in place, especially at a young age, how are you going to utilize them so that they trust the law enforcement officers and they're a little bit more shielded from the media?
So I will tell you one of the things, and it's going to sound funny, we just started a program, and I just started reading about it. It's funny you asked that question. I started reading about it yesterday. Atlanta Police Department started a program where their officers and neighbors, depressed neighbors working with kids, and they call it the Superhero Program. And they're trying to get the officers are superheroes to the kids, right? Good mentors, role models, all those things. That's the people we have to be so selective of who we pick and choose to put in those schools. And if we pick and choose the right men and women, they'll be superheroes to those kids, and that'll fix that problem.
Ron, we've got a couple more questions here, and in respect of everyone's time, it's an hour and 15 minutes of discussion tonight. The next question that's up is, what will you do with the Ford Raptors?
Every one of your business that bought, the ones that have bought federal drug seizure money, I will find the best deal we can, I will sell them, and I will use that money to pay for school resource officers.
Question, what school programs do you plan to implement with those school resource officers? I have been in the schools and seen them sitting behind a desk doing nothing. How will you change that?
Well, the current sheriff's office started a CHAMPS program that's run by the Georgia Sheriff's Association. Nothing wrong with that program. I'm not a big fan of that program. There's some other programs that are out there that have a little better success rates. So I think we really have to sit down. I think this is a big discussion to sit down with a consortium of parents, teachers, board of education folks, and law enforcement folks, and find out what is the best thing that we can do that gets our kids started. And I don't think we need to sit here and go, I'm going to do this program. I think we need to look at everything that's out there. And I also will tell you at the end of the day, this is Forsyth County. Our school system is fantastic. Our sheriff's office is pretty smart. We've got some great deputies there. We've got great intellect in our community. We're one of the most educated places in the state of Georgia. If we have to create our own curriculum, we'll create our own curriculum. Why not?
Ron, I know that a lot of people want to get other things to do tonight, so I believe you're going to stay after to answer the questions. Is that right?
Just a little bit on the lighter side, Ron. A lot of us read, focus on Forsyth. What's your position on snakes?
Don't vote for one, too.
Amen.
With the school resource officers, you've had a lot of flack about what the supposed Board of Education director, that he said that it's their decision, it's their final decision, and you know you can't promise anything, and in that regard. So, how are you going to address that?
Well, I can tell you that I've had some conversations with some current BOE members, both candidates for the Board of Education. I said BOD. Superintendent and I, when that came out in the paper, I have no idea how he was quoted. I'm not going to make a guess on what his statement was. Because trust me, I've been on the news a little bit. And I've been on the news a little bit my entire career, being a PIO, public information officer, and those things. And you can talk for 15 minutes in front of a camera or 20 minutes in front of a reporter. And what you said and what gets reported and what gets chopped off is not the same thing. Okay? So I'm not going to make any guess as to what the full conversation was. What I will tell you is I met with him the very morning that came out for 45 minutes, and we talked. And I told him that I did not need the school system to pay for any additional than what they're paying for. And I said this very clearly. If you guys select me as your next sheriff, I promise you the Board of Education is going to pay very close attention to the fact that the citizens of Forsyth County elected someone who made one of his priorities be a police officer in every school. They're elected, superintendent is appointed. They're going to pay attention. And we'll work with them. This is not a jam it down your throat kind of thing. We'll work with them. Let's get down to the nuts and bolts of it. Who's going to say no when I say I want to give you a free police officer, deputy sheriff, to protect your school? At the end of the day, you don't have to pay for it. We'll work together, come up with a curriculum and how we do it. Who's going to say no? That's a terrible idea. I don't want it. It just doesn't make sense. I think we're kind of time.
We are. We've got one last question here, and I promise I can't make this up.
Shelly?
We've got one question for you, and then there's one question for me, believe it or not. I'm going to answer in a second. This question is, where will the celebration be held?
Well, we got more. So we'll work on that. So I will say this. Listen, there's a lot of people here who obviously are in support of us, and I'm so blessed and so humbled that you are. And there's a lot of people here I don't know. I mean, I'm looking at some faces I don't know. And I hope you don't think if you know me that I'm thinking about you or talking about you. But there are some people that I don't know, and I'm very humbled to have this many people show up for a town hall. I hope you think we've been transparent. If I didn't tell you, if you want, my Brookhaven and my Forsyth County personnel files are sitting on the table over there. Every one of them certified copy. You can look through. God, I've been doing this for almost 30 years. I've never been this one in 30 years. It's not because I'm the best police officer or anything like that. It's who I am. The sheriff officer's here, and I will give him the same opportunity. If not, so I will take the opportunity. I'm going to ask for your vote. If you haven't voted, please, early voting is tomorrow, 7 to 7. And it's on Tuesday from 7 to 7. But you have to vote at your precinct, your normal voting precinct on Tuesday. I'm going to ask for one more favor from you, if you have the time, if you're willing. We need volunteers on Saturday to help us walk neighborhoods, make phone calls, and wave signs. And more importantly, we need about 50 people to work polls, wave signs, give out water, and do things on Tuesday during the election. Even if you can only work an hour or two, even if only a couple hours you can do, we're going to have some sign-up stuff on the back here. I would really appreciate it. You could just say your name, phone number, email would be great too, and I can work 2 hours. We'll work out the polls. We'll do a mass email to you. I'm asking for your help. Believe it or not, there's a lot of undecided voters. We all know, I don't want to say uneducated voters. They're uninformed. They haven't heard. They haven't seen. And sometimes, believe it or not, waving a sign and somebody nice waving at them can have an effect on that undecided voter that's coming in. So I'm asking for your help for that. So if you will, please, folks in the back, take your information. We'll go from there.
Real quick, can we recognize Colonel Gene Moss here to help put this sheriff's office back in order and just make it complete? Would you stand up?
Guys, again, thank you on behalf of Dana, my wife, and I, and all of our campaign team. God bless you. Thank you for being here. I'm going to be here. If you got a hard question or you didn't want to ask it out loud, I'm here. I'll answer anything you got. You can probably stump me, but I'll try it anyway. Okay? I'll give it my best shot.
So I was asked the question. They want to know what my connection was to all this. And the answer is, I'm a concerned citizen of Forsyth County. That's it. I'm not the law enforcement. I'm here because I believe in this man. I think it's a shame that Dwayne Piper didn't come here tonight, because I know there are a lot of people here that would have liked to ask him some hard questions, and he did it on tape. And thank you, Ms. Tisdale, for being here. Thank you.
You still drink? Please take it with you. Please. Thank you. Guys know people I don't know. Please go call 10 people, text 10 people, email 10 people you know that are eligible to vote in this, and you can make a big difference for this. Please reach out and do that. I should have asked, I didn't. I'm asking now. Please reach out to even 10 more that you haven't reached out to. Hi, I'm Ron Freeman, and I'm running for sheriff of Forsyth County.